death before life. You know, we have to die to self. The Apostle Paul puts it this way, be ye crucified with Christ. And the old things have passed away and all things have become new. And so the old man has to die, so we have to die before we live. We have to die in the carnal, to be reborn in the spirit. The tongue twister there. But, you know, we know that from John 3:16, don't we? When he told Nicodemus, he said, you must, not John 3:16, but John 3:3, he said, you must be born again. You know, you have to die to the flesh and be born in the spirit, or you don't go to heaven. And Nicodemus said, hey, I'm on the Supreme Court of the nation of Israel. I'm an honest man, a devout man. I have judged honestly my whole life. I don't cheat nobody. How come I can't go to heaven? And Jesus said, you can't be good enough to go. You still have to die and be reborn spiritually, or you don't go to heaven. Can't be good enough. But when you walk in the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit, Paul said, there's no law against the fruits of the Spirit. I mean, how are you going to get up and say they got too much love? How can you condemn somebody for love and family? How can you condemn somebody who said they got too much peace? You know, well, I don't like that person. They got too much joy. You know, and you go on too much meekness, too much, the whole, all the nine fruits, too much goodness, too much faithfulness, too much temperance. All those nine fruits, Paul said, against the nine fruits, they're you can't come against these nine fruits that our spirit man produces. That the devil can't even accuse you of doing anything wrong when we live in the spirit and we produce these nine fruits. He has nothing to go to heaven and tell God we're doing wrong. There's no law against it, Pastor God. So if we walk in the spirit, we produce those nine fruits, love, joy, peace, long suffering, meekness, temperance, I can't even quote it, goodness, faith. There's nine on the back wall right there. I can't read it. So, isn't that amazing that when we die, so death has to be done before life. We have to die to self to really live. I've told you, and a lot of people don't understand it. I never started to live until I was 41 years old when I accepted Jesus Christ. I didn't know what living was. I existed from day to day. But when I accepted Jesus, I found out how great a life it is to serve God. You know, to really, really, really serve God. It's wonderful. I mean, you go to sleep at night, you don't worry about nothing. You don't worry about dying. You don't worry about any bad news on the phone. How many of you hate to get a 2 o'clock phone call? 2 or 3 in the morning if you got kids. The one thing if your kids are out of town, you do not want a phone call at 3 a.m. Because they're never good. It's either your kid's in jail or your kid's been in a wreck, you know, or blah, 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 something bad. You know, well, we don't have to worry about that. When we really, really, and that, to me, that makes it all worthwhile. You know, just the peace that God brings. If He didn't have the other eight, I could just live on the peace. You know, the Bible says God brings a peace that passeth all understanding. We don't understand the peace He brings, but we don't have to understand it. We just receive it and live in it. We don't have to, we can be at peace about any situation. You know, the woman who's in the Bible, the woman whose son died, ran to the preacher, and she told the preacher that she said, "I got to go find a preacher because my son's dead. If I can find a preacher, he'll raise him from the dead." And when he seen her running, he said, "What's the matter?" And she said, "Nothing. All is well. But oh, by the way, would you come to my house and raise my dead teenage son?" But she didn't say, "Oh, my God, if you don't come, my son's died." She said, "It's all good. So, because I know, I have peace. I know that when you come, he won't be dead anymore." So I got peace about it. All is well, but you didn't, but I come to get you. Yeah. I mean, you know, I mean, how many of us are at that place where that widow woman was where we could say that? Probably very few. You know? But, Brother Joe Justice texted me and he said, "God told him my wife shall live nor die." And he said, "I'm at peace now. I just got to go through the process." Now that God's told me, he said, "I was in turmoil. I was in terrible shape." He texted a day or two earlier, since your daughter told how he was about at his wits' end and couldn't stand it. And all of a of a sudden, as he prayed, the Spirit walked in on him and said, your wife's living, not dying. And now he has peace. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. It's awesome, you know, because God cares about Brother Joe. He loves Brother Joe. You know? And so, when your wife is in that condition, she ain't the only one hurting. You know, if it was your wife or your husband, you'd be hurting. You'd be hurting. Maybe hurting worse than they are because you're up here dealing with it. How about travail before birth? You know, the old time you got a beautiful little granddaughter, but your daughter had to go through some pain. There's always pain before birth. At least that's what the women say. You know, I never have experienced that. When my second was born, I was bold. Well, come on, I've never been one with the most sense of the world. You know, my oldest brother thought I was retarded. And so my first baby took her 22 hours. So when she had the second one, I was thinking, I got 22 hours to kill. So I went bald. Now this was back before they let you in the room. In my day, you went to the waiting room and you didn't do nothing. You waited. They never let the man back there with his wife, at least not in the Scobie General. So I went and bowled. When I come back, my mother's like, where you been, boy? I said, bowled? You got a baby boy back there. We also didn't know the sex. They didn't have the ultrasound now to determine. I don't know if it was a boy or girl. I know it had a girl, I mean the boy, because it's always more fun to have one of each. And so I got the boy. He's born while I'm bowled. She's in labor 45 minutes. So, but there's still some travail. There's some pain, but at least that's what these ladies tell me. You know, one of them tell you it's the worst pain I've ever felt. And we go, yeah, I don't know. They go, no, you don't. You know. I had one lady tell him, you know, she said, if I had my husband right here while I'm going through these labor pains, I'd just take him, couch his eyes out. You did this to me, you're going to die. Well, that's pretty long pain. I don't know if that's true or not. How about tribulation before patience? In the book of Romans, it says, what works patience? Tribulation works patience, don't it? The psalmist said in the book of Psalms, I was glad that tribulation came upon me because it sent me to learn your statutes. And when I learned the law and obeyed the law, the tribulation went away. I mean, you know, I'm always telling about Kelly, you know. Tribulation came when she slapped a cop because the law says you can't slap a cop. You know, and tribulation came. I think she went to 2 stints in jail for that. You know, because, you know, and once she learned, and asked Kelly, have you slapped one since?
No.
That's amazing, isn't it? You know, once she learned, you can't slap a cop. She don't do it no more. Once we learn what God says no to, we don't do it no more, if we got any sense.
Right.
In tribulation, and, you know, I said, God taught us patience way back in the beginning. He brought us out of Egypt, our forefathers, and he said, you follow me. And nowhere did he say, you get ahead of me. He said, you follow me. I will be a fire. I will be a cloud by day and a fire by night. When the cloud stops, you stop. When the fire stops, you stop. And you don't take off on your own. You don't go get ahead of God. You have to follow God. And those that get ahead of God went out and got destroyed, didn't they? They stopped. When the fire stopped by night, they camped right there, Jack, and they waited for the fire to move. Or if the next day, if the cloud came up and the cloud moved, then they would pick up camp and they would move with the cloud, and when the cloud said stop, they would stop. And because the one thing about the wilderness experience they had is for 40 years, they followed God, and he produced food every day. He fed them manna, and their shoes didn't wear out. Their clothing did not wear out. It's almost like a type of, I'll take care of you until we get to the river. And when you cross over, you're on your own. Because when they crossed over the river, The manna stopped. The manna that they had, God said, you can't even take that manna into the Canaan. You can't cross Jordan with the manna. And there was never any more manna. So then they had to go to work. But a lot of Christians don't understand that. I get saved and I got to go to work? Yeah. That's exactly what you do. God didn't save you for you. He saved you for somebody else. How many know that? Look at your neighbor and say, God didn't save you for you.
God didn't save you for you.
He saved you for somebody else.
He saved you for somebody else.
So what God raised us up as an army. What does an army do? We go fight for the ones that aren't able to fight, Brother Robert. We're out here fighting for our unsaved loved ones that are out here in darkness, aren't we? God saved you to get them in. You are the first fruits. If you're the first one in your family, you're the first fruits. The first fruits, somebody has to be the first fruit to be given to God so the rest of them will come. In my family, there's about 300 of us in our three generations that were alive. And we had one cousin. I'm 10 years old. He came to my house and we scared at him. Because if Mama gave him a cookie, he would pray over that cookie. And we'd run and hide. And that man is weird. That man, we didn't know what he's doing. He just bowed his head. He sees his lips moving. And what's he doing before he eats this cookie? I think he must be local. But he got saved. 35 years. Only two or three got saved. Then all of a sudden, after 35 years, the dam broke. And within the next 15 years, 280 or so of the 300 got saved. If we persevere in our salvation, if we walk the walk and talk the talk for somebody else, it will happen. And now then, we went from all getting drunk at family reunions, and usually if we didn't have two men fighting, we'd have husbands and wives fighting. Because alcohol is a spirit, and that bad spirit brings out the worst in us. Well, sometimes it don't, but I hate crying drunk, don't you? People get drunk with crying, I'm crying on the shoulder. They say if you take a country song and play it backwards, you get your house back, your wife back, and your dog back. But we went from that to now all we get is a bunch of them are up singing gospel music and everybody's having a good time. And the few that ain't saved are afraid to act rebellious because they're in a bunch of saved people. Well, they don't want to be the only black sheep in the bunch, so they act nice even if they ain't saved. It started with one man. God, and he didn't just run and get saved. He married a godly woman. And she went to church, and one day said, I ain't going to church no more. She said, I'm going to church. And he took his gun. And he said, I'll kill you. You're not going to church. I don't want to live that life. And we ain't never lived that life. There ain't been a four to live that life, but I'm going to live that. And she, what she told him? She said, you shoot me. But I'm walking out that door. I'm going to church. So if you're going to shoot me, shoot me. But I love Jesus most, and I'm going. And by the way, if you won't go with me, you need to have your bags back time to get home. Because I don't want to live with a man that don't want Jesus. And he said, before church was out, I snuck in the back of that church and set my little butt down. And I've been following God ever since. And then pretty soon, God got a hold of me. So, and that's how God got our faith. How do you get yours? Maybe your testimony will be like mine. I didn't do it, but my cousin did. And my mom had eight boys. She couldn't get none of us saved. So she began to pray, send in a godly woman. So God sent me and BJ, or BJ and me. So, and then pretty soon, almost all of us are saved. Because she'd go to them and work relentlessly to get them saved. We'd buy Bibles, leave it on their doorstep. When they wouldn't read it, we'd leave it there and they'd have to open it up. One brother would take the garage and burn it, and we'd just leave another. What do you got to do? I guarantee you our church, our people will prosper when we help the missionaries do that. We will prosper when we got the jail ministry started. You know why Ernest is sitting right there? One of the big reasons is because our jail minister went to him and somebody showed him while he was locked up that they cared, didn't Ernest? Huge difference in your life. And now you're on fire for God. And then the little man sitting in front of you there is the one that came in there and told you about Jesus and helped you to make that turn around. So everything we do, we're saved to do help. We're going to impact somebody else's life. But we get all the good stuff while we're doing that. You know, there ain't a person that ain't. I made a statement. I said, you paid your tithes to this church for 1 year. And if you will look me in the eye and say, you never did nothing for me, I'll give them all back. I've never had anybody come and say, I want God to take back what he's done for me for that money. And nobody. Because nobody wants to give up what God does because he didn't lie to us when he said he'd bless us. How about suffering before glory? Jesus had suffered before glory, didn't he? He had to go to the cross. How about works before reward? 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11 through 15. Work before reward. Very few of us, I mean, everything we got in America mostly, at least in the early days of America, was based on the Bible. But how many of y'all get your check a week before you work? Or do you get paid after you turn your hours? You have to work before you get your reward. How many of you would work if you didn't get a reward? How many of you, Tammy, would you continue to work if they said, you know what, Tammy, you're welcome to do what you're doing, but no more pay? No. None of us would. We'd say, guess what? I ain't showing up. If I don't get a reward for my work, I'm not going to work. Well, if we don't understand the rewards of working for God, do you know if you pay your tithes, you know what awesome thing you're doing? You're one day a week, you're working for God. I mean, one day out of every 10, that day you're saying, I don't even get paid today. That money goes to God. That's his money. Every 10 days, God's. What I mean? And that's pretty awesome, isn't it? If you think about it, the tithes, they're doing a pretty awesome thing. I mean, when you think about it, I'm going every 10th day, I don't even get paid for the day. Well, that speaks highly of people. So why are we highly exalted? Because we're highly trained people by God. We're willing to go work that one day out of 10. You know, I guess you could take a day, you know, and say, well, this is God's day. And then some of us, we say, well, this is God's day, I'm going to call up sick. That would be terrible, wouldn't it? How about fight before victory? How can you win a victory if you don't have a fight? A victory is overcoming. Amen? Fight before victory. How about temptation before overcoming? You can't be an overcomer unless you've been tempted. Jesus was tempted of everything, the Bible says, of everything that we've been tempted with, Jesus was tempted. But he's an overcomer because he never allowed himself to sin, no matter what the temptation was. When asked him, you know, should we pay a tribute to the church? He said, yeah. When he got no money, he said, well, Peter, go down there and take a fish and look in his mouth and go take it to the church. God will supply. When I'm willing to give, God will supply. We'll take that to the church for us. Then, and I had a guy ask me the other day, he said, you know, Jesus never talked about tithing in the New Testament. I said, yeah, he did. He said, where? I said, Matthew 23:23. And Jesus said, you ought to pay tithes. But he said, don't leave out mercy and faith. Don't leave out those. Don't go pay tithes and think you don't have to have faithfulness and mercy. Because you do. It don't mean you have to not do the others. He said, you got to do them all. He goes, really? He wrote that down. Because he'd been in a church that taught him Jesus never talked about tithes. I said, well, he taught you wrong. Because he does talk about it. But, you know, I thought about that. Temptation before overcoming. We have to overcome temptation. And then I'll close with this one. Jesus said in Revelation, we're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. The word of your testimony is yes and amen. The word of your testimony is, hey, I have avoided sin because I was tempted, but I sinned not. The temptation came, but I did just like Jesus. And how many of you know what I'm talking about? Even probably this week, some of us were tempted, but we overcame sin. You know, the temptation is going to come because the devil is a tempter. But we're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of our testimony. So, you know, I hope this helps you to understand the Bible doesn't say some of the junk that's being preached. What it says is there's a process. Bitter before sweet, temptation before overcoming, a fight before victory, humiliation before exaltation, or being humble. You know, the Bible says God hates an exalted person that exalts himself. And he says, be humble, and God said, let me exalt you. You know, the word's all there. It's all offered. And it all ministers to us, don't it? Let's stand in one moment.